Hello and welcome to Political Theatre. India is the largest democracy in the world, and the twists and turns in the world of Indian politics attract everyone's attention. Several political developments take place simultaneously across the country, making it difficult for the people to keep a track of these events and understand their impact. In the next half an hour, we'll bring to you the top political events of the week and analyze and decode them for you. So let's begin with the big story of the week. With just 1 week left for the polling in Karnataka, the campaigning has intensified in the state, with top guns from all political parties holding rallies at various places. This week, BJP also released its vision document with a number of promises for farmers, women and college students.
BJP's chief ministerial candidate B.S. Yediyurappa released his party's election manifesto in Bengaluru on Friday, with an aim to unseat Congress from one of its last major ruling states. The party made promises to reach out to various sections, including farmers, women and students. BJP promised farm loan waiver up to 1 lakh crore rupees and allocation of 1.5 lakh crore rupees for irrigation projects. A scheme to provide 25,000 rupees and 3 grams of gold for brides under the BPL category during their marriage was also promised. Having made alleged corruption under the Siddaramaiah government a major electoral plank, BJP promised to restore the efficacy of the office of Lokayukta. BJP also promised to bring a white paper on the state's financial health under the Congress rule.
This manifesto is the people's manifesto. This manifesto echoes the voice and the aspiration of the people of Karnataka, and especially the ones who are downtrodden, especially the ones who have been left behind by the Congress government. This is the manifesto for the farmers. This is the manifesto for the women. This is the manifesto for youth. This is the manifesto for common man of Karnataka.
Opposition Congress, which released its election manifesto last week, said that the BJP's manifesto has nothing substantial in it.
I don't think the people of Karnataka are going to give any importance of the manifesto of the BJP, because whatever the BJP had sent during 2014 election at the national level, none of those promises have been fulfilled.
Promises and allegations were also heard in election rallies held by star campaigners from both parties. Prime Minister Narendra Modi joined the election trail in the state and addressed 6 rallies this week. Targeting Congress, Modi called the Karnataka government a gold medalist in corruption and Congress leadership drunk on power.
Aap mein sab kuch karne ki taakat hai. Aap chahe wo cheeze siddh karne ka samarth rakhte hain. Lekin shart hai ki jab corruption ki gold medalist ये कांग्रेस को नहीं हटाओगे आपके सपनों के आड़े वो रुकावटें पैदा करते रहेंगे.
The Congress too hit back. Rahul Gandhi questioned Modi's silence over alleged atrocities on Dalits and accused him of muzzling Dalit voice in Parliament.
अंबेडकर जी की बात करेंगे और फिर खड़गे जी को लोकसभा में बोलने नहीं देंगे.
As many exit polls predict a close contest, both parties are going all out to woo this electoral battle, which will set the tone for the 2019 general elections. Another major player in the battle is HD Devegowda's Janata Dal Secular, which is in a position to spoil the election arithmetic of both the parties. Voting for 224 seats in Karnataka will take place in a single phase on May 12th. Counting of votes will be done on May 15th.
For more on these stories, we have with us today our political analyst of the week, Ms. Nistula from The Hindu, the political editor of the paper. Nistula, you've been to Karnataka lately. How do you assess the situation between Congress and BJP per se? Both parties are taking each other head on. A lot of allegations, counter-allegations, issues like farmer, corruption, agriculture, all these are the talk of the town there.
Well, that is to be expected because we are reaching the slog overs of the campaign, and therefore there will be a ratcheting up of rhetoric and very high-pitch campaign rhetoric at that, with the Prime Minister having given extra rallies, six extra rallies from what he had planned to do earlier. You can expect that by the 10th, which is the last day of campaigning, it's going to get much worse before the silence descends. Mm-hmm. And as far as allegations and things are concerned, it is basically the BJP, it's very strange, they're not going with the record that they had in governance between 2008 to 2013, but rather Prime Minister Modi's record from 2014 till now to counter Mr. Siddaramaiah's challenge or the Congress's challenge, because Mr. Siddaramaiah historically, it's a historical feat for the last 40 years or 30 years, he's the first chief minister of the state, 30 years I think, who has managed to complete a full five-year term. So therefore he has a lot to say. And that has to be countered. Mm-hmm. Now, when the BJP was in power between 2008 to 13, there were three chief ministers, and that administration was, you know, riddled with the allegations of corruption, the Ballari brothers, the mining scam, the run-ins with the Lokayukta, the imprisonment of that chief minister, Mr. Yediyurappa, after which we saw Mr. Sadanand Gowda take over, then Mr. Jagdish Shettar. Mm-hmm. So that cannot be, placed against Mr. Siddaramaiah's record, which was about more or less consistent. Therefore, how do you counter that? You counter that with Prime Minister Modi and the record of the union government, what they have done in terms of the farmers, what they have done in terms of development, spending, devolution of funds. So that is what you see at the moment in the campaign.
There's a lot of, rebel voices also in both the camps. It is quite natural in these two big parties whenever there's an election which happens. But given the fact that this is a very neck-to-neck fight which is happening, how crucial do you believe these rebel voices can be?
They will be crucial, but for that you'll have to do a very micro analysis and go seat by seat, because mm-hmm. they're very interesting instances of, you know, both parties declared tickets and then backed off on five to six seats and changed their candidates. Now the person from whom they took away the ticket suddenly becomes a rebel candidate. This is nothing new. It's a very crucial election for both parties, and a lot of people are comparing it to Punjab. But there is a variation to Punjab even here. A, Congress is the sitting government, the incumbent government. Mm-hmm. Secondly, Congress is directly facing the BJP here. In Punjab, the Congress was actually fighting with the Akalis. And BJP was a minor player in that alliance. And therefore, even if they lost, it wasn't so much of a reflection on the BJP as much as the Akalis. So the stakes are extremely high in this election.
Okay, so clearly, but decisions like these, which you mentioned, might come back to haunt the political managers of both the parties, if at all their candidates do not win on those specific seats. Let's take a look at another story here from Karnataka only, and this time about another player in this electoral battle, which is very crucial and is likely to play a very important role in the post-poll scenario. That is the regional outfit of Janata Dal Secular, headed by none other than former Prime Minister H.D. Devegowda.
In the run-up to the Karnataka elections, the focus has shifted to the JDS, the third player in the fray. It all started with Prime Minister Narendra Modi openly praising former Prime Minister and JDS patriarch H.D. Devegowda in the middle of a heated campaign.
When they come to my house, I go to the door and open the door of their car and welcome them. Congress Congress ke adhyaksh chunavi sabhaon mein aaj se 15-20 din pehle jis prakar se aadarniya Devegowda ji ka ullekh kar rahe the, kya ye aapke samskar hai?
The remarks understandably triggered much political speculation about the BJP's political plans as to whether it is getting ready for a post-poll alignment with the JDS, or if it intended to help the JDS to win in seats where it's locked in a straight fight with the Congress. Wary of the prospect of losing their anti-BJP voters, both Gowda and his son Kumaraswamy, however, sought to downplay Modi's remarks. Gowda even recalled the party's earlier coalition with the BJP to say that he would disown Kumaraswamy if he went with the BJP in the case of a hung assembly in future.
Yes, true. This is how Congress gives the respect to a Karnataka who has become the Prime Minister. So that is the only thing which he made in his, he want to gain that sympathy. Maybe. That's all. That doesn't mean there is Gathbandhan.
But soon afterwards, Prime Minister Modi made another remark, seeming to retract his praise for Devagoda by asking the people not to waste their votes on the JDS.
JDS चुनाव तो हारने वाला ही है, उनको कोई पूछने वाला नहीं है.
Amidst all this, the Congress accused the JDS of acting like a B team of the BJP. Its concern evidently to prevent anti-BJP vote from going to the JDS. In Karnataka, the JDS has been in coalition with both the BJP and the Congress in earlier times. Karnataka Chief Minister Siddaramaiah himself was a front-ranking leader of the JDS once. It remains to be seen now how the equations play out in the days to come.
Let's go back to our political analyst of the week, Nistula. Nistula, JDS is a very interesting player and an important one as well. Although it's limited to a particular specific area, the old Mysuru region, but given the kind of statements which have been coming in from both Congress and BJP and from Ajit Devagoda himself, what do you make out of the situation as to how much important can JDS be and what might be its implications?
Well, the old Mysore area has 59 assembly seats, which, as we were discussing it earlier, you said it's one-fourth of the assembly. And it's the Vokkaliga stronghold. And there has been a little bit of a bit of bitterness between the Vokkaliga community and Chief Minister Siddaramaiah, who belongs to the Kurba community and therefore is not seen as being extremely partial to the Vokkaliga community. And therefore, it is being said that in the old Mysore area this time, there has been a Vokkaliga consolidation behind the JDS. Now, when you become a third party in this kind of a scenario, and you do control a chunk of the vote, but you are not evenly spread across the state, the most you can aspire to do is become a kingmaker. So if the JDS, and that's their calculation, is in striking distance about 40 or 42, even 43 seats, then they become extremely crucial because the rest of the parties then don't reach the magic figure, or may not reach the magic figure. So then they become very, very important. So from the beginning, there has been talk that the BJP is in secret talks with them, and whether Congress becomes single largest or not, the BJP is going to form a government with the JDS, and a lot of it is being spread by interested parties in that. Mm-hmm. And on the other hand, the Prime Minister first praises Mr. Devagoda, says that I'm highly respectful to him and Rahul Gandhi is not so respectful. Congress President Rahul Gandhi has not been so respectful to the former Prime Minister. And on the other day, second day, he says that giving a vote to JDS is like voting the Congress back. So please don't do that. Mm-hmm. Where the BJP has a problem is that they are not a presence in that old Mysore area. So, the BJP wants the JDS to do well, if it wants to form a government and alliance. Mm-hmm. Yet it cannot be seen totally to be very, very soft towards the JDS. So it's a very, very strange sort of tightrope that the BJP and the other party, have to walk there. On the other hand, mm-hmm. I know you're going to ask about the Congress, yes. Whether they are... See, a lot has been made out about the personal fight or the personal animus between Chief Minister Siddaramaiah and former Prime Minister Devagoda. Because Mr. Siddaramaiah was the protege of Mr. Devagoda when he started out in politics. And when Mr. Siddaramaiah saw that his political career was going to be put in cold storage because Mr. Devagoda wanted to promote the interests of his son, mm-hmm. Former Chief Minister Kumaraswamy, he quit the party, or he was expelled from the party, and he fought a very, very hard by-poll from Chamundeshwari, the seat he has returned to in this election. He won by a very, very narrow margin of 257 votes. The bitterness of the campaign...
So Siddaramaiah factor will be very important when it comes to Congress JDS. So,
yes, and whether they are able to get over this bitterness, or if JDS, in terms of striking a deal, numbers being what they are, let's just... Mm-hmm. Let's use the ceteris paribus or whatever economic term. The situation being that there is nobody who has a majority. Then will the JDS insist on terms that exclude Mr. Siddaramaiah from the chief ministership? Will the Congress be agreeable to it? Will the Congress then say, okay, we want to form the government, never mind Mr. Siddaramaiah, and push somebody else, a consensus candidate? So these are all things...
Scenarios.
These are all scenarios. So therefore, it makes the JDS's position extremely interesting, and it also makes it very difficult for both parties in terms of rhetoric. Although Mr. Siddaramaiah and Rahul Gandhi, Congress President Rahul Gandhi, have been fairly aggressive with regard to the JDS, with Mr. Rahul Gandhi saying that the JDS is the B team of the BJP.
Okay, so clearly it is a very interesting situation in Karnataka, and JDS is a very crucial player. We'll keep on bringing the latest from Karnataka with our reporters on the ground, and we'll give you the detailed analysis on the counting day as well. That is on 15th, when all these equations will have to fall in place for somebody to form that government for the next 5 years in the state. We'll take a short break here. When we come back, we will give you the details of other political developments happening across the nation and some interesting comments made by political leaders in this week. Stay tuned.
And India has a crucial role to play. India is the biggest member, the largest member of the Commonwealth.
Yeah.
And we want Commonwealth more than just a network of people. We want more than, you know, heads of state getting together.
How can you be the custodian of what is happening in Syria?
We have a responsibility to our fellow human beings, no matter where they're living. You know, Britain is a very compassionate country. We don't attack countries with a view to kill their people.
Watch an exclusive interview of Lord Dollar Popat, trade envoy of the British Prime Minister, Saturday 8:30 p.m. and Sunday 9:30 a.m. only on Rajya Sabha TV.
Welcome back. From political developments in Jammu and Kashmir, Madhya Pradesh and several other states, let's take a look at what else transpired in the political arena across the country this week.
The Jammu and Kashmir government underwent a major cabinet reshuffle this week, with 8 legislators inducted as ministers in the cabinet. Kavinder Gupta, the state assembly speaker, has been sworn in as a new deputy chief minister. The major shake-up includes 6 ministers of the BJP and 2 of the PDP. The new BJP faces sworn in as ministers are parties state unit chief Satpal Sharma and MLAs from Kathua and Samba, Rajiv Jasrotia and Devinder Kumar Manyal respectively. The BJP also upgraded Sunil Sharma to the rank of a cabinet minister. BJP MLA from Doda, Shakti Raj, took oath as Minister of State. The PDP members included in the cabinet are Mohammad Khalil Band, MLA from Pulwama, and Mohammad Ashraf Mir, MLA from Sondar. BJP Chief Amit Shah addressed party workers in Bhopal in Madhya Pradesh. Accusing the Congress of defaming Hindus, Amit Shah said that Rahul Gandhi should apologize for projecting the concept of Hindu terror. Amit Shah also cited the April 16th acquittal by a Hyderabad court of all 5 people accused in the Mecca Masjid blast case, including Swami Asimanand. Shah also accused the Congress of playing divisive politics. Assembly elections in Madhya Pradesh are due later this year. Trinamool Congress MPs met President Ramnath Kovind over allegations made by the BJP regarding poll violence during the filing of nominations for the panchayat polls in the state. A delegation of party MPs, along with the alleged victims of the state panchayat poll violence, went to meet the president. The party said that the allegations raised by the BJP were distorted and misleading in nature, and more than 96,000 nominations have been filed by the opposition parties. Samajwadi Party President Akhilesh Yadav met with Telangana Chief Minister K. Chandrasekhar Rao in Hyderabad this week. The meeting was held to discuss formation of a federal front as a third alternative at the national level. Backing KCR's efforts to unite regional parties ahead of 2019 polls, Akhilesh Yadav said that it was time for regional parties to come together, and the NDA government hasn't fulfilled its promises in the past 4 years. KCR said the agenda would be prepared in the coming months for the proposed coalition in consultation with others. Congress and CPIM have joined hands to take on the ruling TMC in the Maheshtala Assembly bipoll in West Bengal. Samajwadi Party and Rashtriya Lok Dal have also decided to come together for Kairana Lok Sabha and Noorpur Assembly bipolls in Uttar Pradesh. Samajwadi Party Supremo Akhilesh Yadav and RLD leader Jayant Singh held a meeting on Friday on this issue. Congress and NCP have also announced their alliance in Maharashtra, where bipoll will be held for 2 Lok Sabha and 1 Assembly seat. Polling for 4 Lok Sabha and 10 Assembly seats in 10 states will be held on 28th of this month, and counting of votes will be done on 31st May.
Several political situations led to interesting comments from political leaders in a bid to counter each other's claims. We have shortlisted the best ones for you in Face Off.
There's a complete jumla. The last 18,000 villages are electrified in the last 1,000 days. It has taken them 3 years to electrify the last 18,000 villages. Look at the work that is done by previous governments, including 10 years of UPA, which electrified lakhs of villages in those 10 years.
अगर इतना ही आसान था तो उन्होंने कर क्यों नहीं किया? इतने 60-70 साल में क्यों नहीं कर लिया? करके वो अनाउंस कर देते कि देखिए साहब हमने सब कर दिया है ना।
लालू जी को चारा घोटाले में सजा हो चुकी है, मगर वो ही ऑर्डिनेंस फाड़ने वाले राहुल गांधी आज लालू जी को मिलने के लिए जाते हैं और गले लगाकर सरकार बनाने के लिए आगे बढ़ रहे हैं।
इससे क्या मुलाकात हुई? राहुल जी सिर्फ इसलिए गए थे क्योंकि उनको लालू जी की सेहत की चिंता थी, इस वजह से मुलाकात।
देश के प्रजातंत्र, देश के स्वतंत्रता संग्राम, देश की आजादी, देश की अखंडता के सबसे बड़ा चिन्ह अगर कुछ है तो वो देश का लाल किला है, जहां से 70 साल से हमारे प्रधानमंत्री देश को संदेश देते आए हैं। क्या आप इस लाल किले को भी अपने कॉरपोरेट साथियों को गिरवी रख देंगे? क्या लाल किले में जाने के लिए 132 करोड़ लोगों को टिकट लगाई जाएगी? क्या इस लाल किले के अंदर अब कमर्शियल फंक्शंस पैसे देके हुआ करेंगे?
पार्लियामेंट्री स्टैंडिंग कमेटी ऑन टूरिज्म एंड कल्चर, जिसके डेरेक अब्राजी जिसके चेयरमैन हैं, उनकी उपस्थिति के अंदर ये डिस्कस हुआ कि हम मॉन्यूमेंट्स को, सुविधाओं को, सिर्फ मॉन्यूमेंट्स की दीवारों को छूने का, उनके संरक्षण का काम आर्कियोलॉजिकल सर्वे ऑफ इंडिया करता रहेगा, लेकिन उनके आसपास की सुविधाएं, पार्किंग, पार्क, कोई बैटरी ऑपरेटेड कार, वहाँ का टॉयलेट्स, वहाँ की पानी पीने की सुविधाएं, अगर जन भागीदारी, ऐसा नहीं भारत सरकार के पास धन की कमी है, हम उसका काम नहीं कर सकते, लेकिन एक जन भागीदारी हमारे प्रधानमंत्री जी का सपना है कि जन भागीदारी को हम साथ लेकर चले।
Apart from television studios, protest marches and public rallies, politicians were also busy taking a dig at each other and making their point on social media. Let's take a look at what has transpired in the virtual world of Indian politics.
As India achieved electrification of all its villages this week, Prime Minister Narendra Modi called April 28th a historic day in India's development journey. In another tweet, Modi said that with electrification of the last village, Lisang, in Manipur, it will make every Indian proud and delighted. But Congress spokesperson Randeep Surjewala took to Twitter and accused BJP of taking fake credit for his party's work. He said that it took BJP government 46 months to complete electrification at an average of 4,813 villages per year. Amid hectic campaigning, Prime Minister Narendra Modi lashed out at Congress leaders for insulting JDS Supremo H.D. Devagowda and called him one of the most respected political leaders. Modi was referring to Rahul Gandhi's speeches where he attacked Devagowda and called his party the B team of the BJP. Karnataka Chief Minister Siddaramaiah targeted the BJP and called both BJP and JDS part of the Mutual Admiration Club. Siddaramaiah also accused both the parties of working together against the Congress in the state elections. B.S. Yediyurappa announced on Twitter its party's election promise of giving farm loan waiver to be his government's first priority if BJP is elected to power. But Chief Minister Siddaramaiah said that BJP's farm loan waiver promise will bring financial ruin to the state as the loan waiver will cost the state 42,000 crore rupees, which is 20% of the state's total budget. Jammu and Kashmir Chief Minister Mehbooba Mufti and former Chief Minister Omar Abdullah condemned the stone pelting incident on a school bus in Shopian district this week, in which a second-class student was injured. Mufti expressed shock and anger on the incident and promised to take action. Omar Abdullah tweeted that some pelters are misusing the amnesty given to the stone pelters by the state.
So this was the summary of twists and turns in the world of Indian politics this week. We'll be back again next week with some more interesting information and analysis. Till then, we will leave you with these visuals of the week.